started boxing here at Collyhurst and Moston's Lads Club when you were 16 under the guidance of Brian Hughes.
Yeah.
Did you ever envisage, you know, 20 odd years later, you'd be here continuing, you know, the great work Brian
set? No, I never would have thought it out, to be quite honest with you. I didn't have nothing planned for my career when I finished boxing, what I would do. I just thought I'd probably just finish and finish on top somehow.
Yeah. And, you know, do you remember that first day when you walked into the gym? Up them stairs and...
I never forget it. I used to always walk every day from Harper Hay with my gym bag. I used to walk to the gym every day. Now you wouldn't catch me walking anywhere, but yeah, I used to walk every day to the gym for about 2-3 years from Harper Hay.
And the first time you met Brian and walked in the gym, did you know this is what you wanted to do?
No, I didn't actually look at it like that. I used to actually follow my brother, my older brother Michael Barrett, really. We did a bit of kickboxing, well, he did, and I followed him into that. He did a bit of boxing, and I followed him into that. And I was very fortunate because I was very good at what I did. My brother, he did it more as a hobby kind of thing. He didn't do it to become successful. Brian took a shine on him, thought I could do it, and you know, he told me that I've got the ability to become a world champion. I never believed him. I just thought he was just saying that. And you know, he believed in me as much as I believed in him, and you know, he done great with us.
And you know, the influence he had on your boxing career, I know he also had a big influence on your life as well.
Yeah, but I mean, if it wouldn't have been through Brian, I mean, he gave me really, really good. He gave me really good guidance, and he actually, you know, when I was making money, he made me save money up, put money away. I mean, he did everything right with us. I mean, he took me in like a son, really. Especially when my mum died, he was the only person that I had, and he's always been there for us. You know.
Did you always want to be a boxer?
No, not at all. I had no intention that when I come to this gym, I would become a British champion on the European title and fight for a world title. No way.
It was Brian who encouraged you and so.
Brian encouraged me, Brian made me believe it, but I obviously, it's like what I do now with some of the lads. I tell them how good they are and they look at me and say how stupid I am. So I can understand where they come from in that aspect. And, you know, it's a very similarity because sometimes you think people's blowing smoke just for the wrong reasons, just to keep you out of trouble, you know, for all the wrong reasons. But I tell these kids, listen, you know, there's a pot of gold out there for you. And if you want to make it, you've got all the ability to stick with what you're doing, and the next day they're out doing something stupid. So I know where they're coming from there, and that's what I thought with Brian when he told me I would become a champion one day.
You feel like you can instill that in them and what Brian did with you and keep them,
well,
learn from what you did?
There's one good thing Brian taught me, and one brilliant thing he told me, I'll never forget this. He said to me, if you're ever going to do it, yeah, don't do it for the money, do it for the love, because it's pointless doing it for the money. And that's, you've got to become passionate about what you're doing. If you're not passionate about what you're doing, then it's pointless. Another great thing he taught me as well was how to train a fighter's mind more than the body, because anybody can be a trainer or a coach. Yeah, you know, stopwatch, do this, do that, do that. But if you don't understand the fighter's mind, yeah, then, you know, that's what makes a good coach and a good trainer. Is a trainer that can actually understand the fighter's mind, because you don't just physically train him, you have to mentally get him ready. And the mental part to getting a fighter ready is the hardest part. I wasn't really, you know, as a pro, I only turned pro for the money, to be quite honest with you. And I remember looking at all these trophies on the side one day, and I remember counting them and thinking, wow, if I got £100 for every one of them trophies, I'd have like £3,500. And back in them days, £3,500 was a lot of money. And considering my mum just passed away, and boxing was about the only thing that we had left, and I decided, you know what, I'm going to go pro. And I remember saying to Brian, listen, Brian, I want to go pro. I'm only doing it for the money, and I don't want to do nothing else. But Brian wouldn't let me do it just for the money. He made sure that I did it because I was going to become a champion, because that's what he always believed. But I thought, okay, I'll go along with this little dream of Brian's. I'll say I want to become a champion. You just get me as much money as you can. And I remember winning my first pro fight, winning my second, and I was getting paid. And I was only on some like £600 a fight. And I signed up with a guy called Tommy Miller. And Tommy Miller was a kind of manager that he would provide fighters for someone like Mickey Duff, Frank Warren. You know, he just had fodders, you know, people that just turn up to get beat. And I remember the first year having 11 pro fights, and then I moved to another manager called Alec Morrison. And the second year, I had 12 pro fights, so altogether I had 23 fights within 2 years. And within them 2 years, I was became the British, no, Central Area, and the British champion. And I've also fought for the European within them 2 years. So it all happened so quick for me, really, to be quite honest with you.
Pat, you know, going back to your career, your professional career, you turned pro in 1987, aged 18. And the first year you had 7 fights, winning 6 and losing the one against Paul Burke, a close points decision. What do you remember about that time and, you know, experiencing that first defeat early in your career? Did it set you on the path?
I think it was the most horriblest feeling you could ever possibly have when you get lose, and especially in the pro games. And I remember thinking to myself, this will never happen to me again. And I remember going back to the gym, back to the drawing board and training so, so, so hard and listening and practicing and learning that, yeah, 5 years, I was unbeaten for 5 years after that Paul Burke fight. And I just remember it saying it would never happen again, because I think it's the most sickliest feeling you can ever possibly imagine having.
And you know, did that early defeat, did it make you realise there's no favours in boxing, and you know, you had to get your focus back and determine that, you know, it wouldn't happen again?
No, it just made me realise that which direction I wanted to go in boxing, that it wasn't just for the money, that I found the love in boxing. After I had 2 pro fights and I lost my 3rd one, it made me realise that I found myself in boxing, that I did believe that I was going to do it, because I wouldn't have felt so cut up and so hurt if I wanted to just do it just for the money, even though I fought and I convinced myself that I wanted to just do it for the money. And then I realised, hang on, why am I hurting so much? And then I realised from that day on, I said, I'm never going to get beat again. And because Brian had so much belief in me, I thought, I'm not going to let this man down. So I started taking it a lot more serious and training a lot more harder and staying a lot more focused. And he was right. I couldn't fault him, he was right. When I took it to that extreme, I was unbeaten. I couldn't be beat. To believe the same thing as what Brian believed in, it changed me. It became so different. And after the fight, I get a knock on the door. I was Brian, and I was always glad to see Brian, but I knew that he bared some kind of news. So I was, oh, how you doing, Brian? Come in. I was always happy to see him. Goes, Pat, I've got good news. And I got bad news.